Your Honor. Could you state your name for the record, please?
Yes, ma'am. My name is David Lockley.
And Mr. Lockley, could you please spell your last name?
Yes, ma'am. L-O-C-K-L-E-Y.
And Mr. Lockley, where are you employed?
I'm employed with the Mississippi Forensics Laboratory in Pearl, Mississippi.
And what do you do there?
I am the section chief for toxicology of the laboratory.
And what is toxicology for?
Toxicology is the study of essentially poisons and how they work on the body. It is finding essentially what things do to the body and at what concentrations and the effects of those drugs. Excuse me.
Could you give us the benefit of your education and training?
Yes, ma'am. I earned a Bachelor of Science in Forensic Chemistry from the University of Mississippi, as well as completed an extensive training program at the Mississippi Forensics Laboratory in Alcohol and Drug Toxicology.
Do you hold any certifications or licenses in toxicology?
Yes. In addition to the certification from the Mississippi Forensics Laboratory, I'm also certified by the American Board of Forensic Toxicology.
Okay. And how long have you practiced as a
I've been employed with the crime lab for over 15 years.
We don't have you to accept it to make sure we have any of this.
All right.
Thank you, Your Honor. Thank you.
All right. Since there's no objection from the defendant, the court will accept Mr. Lockley as an expert.
Thank you, Your Honor. And Mr. Lockley, you performed an analysis of a Beth Ann White's blood, is that correct?
That's correct.
And could you tell us what you did in performing that analysis?
Sure. Once a sample comes into the laboratory, it is assigned a request. It then is retrieved by the analyst who's assigned that particular piece of evidence. At that point, I would take that piece of evidence, retrieve it from our vault in our evidence section. I would open that case up, ensure that all the descriptions match everything that is within our laboratory information management system. I would then complete a worksheet, noting any details about that sample, name, what type of tubes, what type of sample may be present on that. At that point, I would take a small portion of that sample, I would place it into a vial, seal that vial, place it on an instrument called a gas chromatograph with a flame ionization detector. It would then analyze those samples. I would then retrieve the data, interpret that data, and produce a report to be issued to law enforcement agency or the requesting agency.
And did you issue a report in this situation?
Yes, I did.
What were you specifically testing for Beth Ann White?
The first analysis was specifically what is called an alcohol analysis. It is a volatile analysis that looks for the primary analytes of interest are methanol, ethanol, isopropanol, and acetone.
And what were your findings?
You may.
My finding for this case was that the blood from tube labeled Beth White contained an ethyl alcohol concentration of 0.273%.
And what is the legal limit in Mississippi?
The legal limit for the state of Mississippi for a driver over the age of 21 is 0.08%.
So she's three times over the legal limit?
Yes, that is more than three times the legal limit.
And based on your training and your education, can you tell us a person that is over the 0.08, what kind of, what things you might observe about them? How would they be affected by alcohol?
Sure. So alcohol is essentially a drug, and the impairing effects of alcohol increase with the increasing dosage of ethanol. So the more you have in your system, the more concentrated, more pronounced the effects are. So when driving cases, like people in driving cases with high levels of ethanol, we're seeing things like divided attention, small motor coordination is involved, diminishes. You're more likely to take risk, so you have.
All right, you may proceed. Go ahead.
You're more likely to take risks that you might not normally do. You have decreased inhibitions, so like I said, things that you might not normally do under normal circumstances, you're, you may be inclined to do that. As I mentioned, divided attention. Driving is a complicated task. For normal people, we don't think about what all involved in a driving a car, but you're dealing with hand-eye coordination with your steering wheel, with your turn signals, coordination between your feet and the pedals with the brake. You're also looking for things with, say, distance determination between yourself and other vehicles, speed, recognition of yourself, things of that nature. These are all things that can be diminished when you're under the influence of alcohol. You're also dealing with other signs such as sometimes red eyes, but more associated when you have diplopia, which is double vision, can occur. You also get surge speech, staggered gaits, things of that nature that are normally associated with CNS depressants.
What about vomiting?
Vomiting can occur at higher levels of alcohol. Sometimes due to the type of alcohol that's consumed, otherwise it could also be due to the amounts of alcohol that may be consumed, can induce vomiting as well.
And in your analysis, did you look further than just the alcohol? Did you look for other substances in her system?
Yes, we did.
And what were your findings there?
In addition to the alcohol analysis, a drug screen analysis was also performed. In this particular case, the blood from the tube was screened at the Mississippi Forensics Laboratory, and it was sent to National Medical Services for confirmational analysis. Excuse me. And in, for this particular case, National Medical Services concluded there was presence of caffeine, cocaine, which is a nicotine metabolite, delta-9 carboxy THC, which is the inactive metabolite of marijuana, hydrocodone, which is an opiate, and amitriptyline, its metabolite, which is a tricyclic antidepressant.
And we provided you with the medical records of Evan and White. Do you recall that?
Yes.
And were you able to review those?
I did.
Okay. And we've had prior testimony, and I'm sure you saw on the record that there was nothing given to her before that blood was drawn.
Yes, to my mind.
You would agree with that?
Yes.
Okay. So those substances were in her system at the time of the wreck. Would you agree with that?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, you talked about the effects of those drugs on the system. What about when combined with alcohol? Is there any additional added effect?
Yes, ma'am. So when we're talking about drugs with ethanol, there are two different effects we can have. We can have an additive effect, which is a more synergistic effect. An additive effect is essentially two drugs, 1 + 1 = 2. So the effects of the combined are additive to each other, or you have a synergistic effect, which is essentially 1 + 1 = 3. So you have a greater than effect than just the two combined. With these cases, the hydrocodone and the amitriptyline also being CNS depressants can have an additive effect in addition to the ethanol that is in the system.
Okay. And what about the driving ability to drive with that additional effect? How would that be impacted?
It would exhibit many of the same symptoms of the driving impairment with alcohol.
But that would be further complicated?
Yes.
What's in there?
All right.
Let me cross-examine.
Thank you, Your Honor. Okay, David, we've had a chance to talk before, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And we talked about, I guess, the alcohol that was in the best system, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And the first question we'll ask you is, at the time of driving, what was her BAC?
I do not know what it was at the time of driving.
Okay. So you can't, today as we sit, you can't tell this jury that she had a BAC above 408, is that right?
No, I cannot.
Now, you talked about, I guess there was you did a test, and the test that you did came back as a .273.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And you said some of the different things that, I guess, applicant person is under the influence of alcohol, correct?
Yes, sir.
And you said that at different levels, different things were happening. Okay. We don't know what was happening when, I guess, when Beth was driving, because we don't know what her BAC was at that time, correct?
Yes, I was at all present with her.
Okay. And so we do not know what effects that she would have been suffering, because we don't know what her BAC was being.
That's correct. The effects that I give are the effects that would affect the general population under other effects of alcohol.
Gotcha. And, okay, what else was found in her system? I think you were reading, if you want to.
Yes, sir. In addition to the ethanol, it was also confirmed that it was caffeine.
Okay, is caffeine a controlled substance?
No, sir, it's not.
Okay. Does caffeine affect you negatively in any way?
Caffeine is a mild stimulant, but under general circumstances, no.
And normally, what do people use caffeine for?
Caffeine is generally found in things like soft drinks, energy drinks, coffee, things of that nature. It's generally in a liquid form.
Yeah, you have your morning coffee to get you going.
Yes, sir.
Okay. What was the next thing?
The next thing was cocaine, which is a metabolite of nicotine.
Okay. What is a metabolite?
So, a metabolite is the byproduct of a drug. Many drugs, when they're ingested into the body, they don't stay as that parent drug. They break down into what's called a metabolite or a byproduct.
Okay, so nicotine you get from what?
Nicotine comes from generally cigarettes, tobacco. Some of it now is found in vape pens, things of that nature.
Okay, and is that a controlled substance?
It is not.
Okay, where do we commonly see, nicotine?
So, as I said, nicotine is generally found in cigarettes, tobacco, whether it be smoking tobacco, non-smoking tobacco, such as snuff, chewing tobacco, and then, as I said, also found in vape pens and things like that. You can also find it in nicotine cessation patches for people that are trying to quit smoking, as well as cessation gum as well.
Okay.
That's the general body.
And a metabolite even means that that's not the nicotine, you're not seeing the nicotine actually in the system, you're seeing the metabolite that is formed because the nicotine is in the system. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
What was the next thing?
The next thing was delta-9 carboxy THC.
Okay, now carboxy THC.
Yes, sir.
Okay, what is that?
All right, so delta-9 carboxy THC is one of the main metabolites of delta-9 THC, which is the main psychoactive component in marijuana. Delta-9 carboxy THC is an inactive metabolite, which means it's not performing anything on the body at the time. So once a person ingests delta-9 THC, whether it be through smoking, orally, that is not anything with edibles, it goes into the body, it rapidly increases with delta-9 if it's smoked, and then decreases out and metabolized into delta-9 carboxy THC, which is the inactive metabolite in the body to be processed out.
And so, now, marijuana can be legal, it can be illegal, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. And what you're seeing there is the inactive metabolite again. It's not saying that the active ingredient is in the blood, it's the inactive ingredient, which would not have any effect.
That's correct.
Okay. Now what's the next one?
The next one was hydrocodone.
Okay.
And hydrocodone is an opiate. It's a narcotic analgesic. It's used for relieving of pain. And that is the active ingredient in hydrocodone. Hydrocodone itself is actually an active ingredient.
Now how long can hydrocodone stay in the blood?
Hydrocodone has a half-life of about 8 hours or so. So it has a relatively longer half-life because you want that onset of action to stay with the person to relieve any kind of pain that they may be using that for.
So is it reasonable to say you could take hydrocodone the day before and you're still going to have residual effects in your blood, correct?
Yes, depending on the dosage unit and the prescription dosage of that is possible.
And what you're seeing here is a residual amount, correct?
It's not necessarily residual. It was found at 11 nanograms per milliliter. 11 nanograms per milliliter of hydrocodone is within what literature shows to be a therapeutic amount. Therapeutic amount being an amount that somebody may be using at a, say, a doctor's prescribed dosage. It does not show, say, an abusive amount, which may be highly elevated, to show that somebody may be necessarily taking an abusive amount of hydrocodone.
So is there any idea of when that would have been taken?
No, sir. It would have been prior to that.
Okay. And what else was found?
The other thing that was found is amitriptyline and nortriptyline. Amitriptyline is a tricyclic antidepressant. It can have some sedative effects as well on the body.
Okay. When you said can, so it's not even, doesn't even have that effect all the time?
It depends. A lot of it sometimes depends on the person, but it is a drug that can have sedative effects on the person.
Okay. Now, you said there were two of them, amitriptyline and
nortriptyline.
Okay. Yes. Now, is that one of them's, are those the same thing, or what is it?
So, amitriptyline is the parent drug that's given, and it is broken down into nortriptyline, which is an active metabolite of that drug. So, it breaks itself down into an active metabolite, prolonging the duration of usage of that drug. Typically, your tricyclic antidepressants are used as what we would consider a maintenance drug. They're something that should be taken constantly. They're not something that you would want to just essentially stop cold turkey. The side effects can be worse than taking the drug itself.
So, okay, so that's something that somebody's taking on a regular basis?
In general, yes, sir.
Okay. And so if you're taking it, how long does it say it was?
Amitriptyline has a much longer half-life of over 12 hours.
Okay.
So.
So it's going to be you're taking that to keep it in your blood the entire time.
Yes, sir.
Now, which of those would be controlled substances?
Out of the all three, I believe, are controlled substances.
Okay, the amitriptyline, the hydrocodone, and the marijuana. I guess.
The marijuana would be a controlled substance.
Okay, but the marijuana was it was the inactive ingredient.
It was, but the only way to get the inactive would be to use the actual product.
Right. I mean, but as far as what would have been in the blood system at the time of driving, well, would the marijuana's active ingredient have been in there
at the time of the driving?
Yeah.
It is possible it could have been there, but it was not confirmed at the time of the blood draw.
Okay, so you have nothing to show that it would have been there.
I don't know if it was there or not. There's a possibility, but I don't know.
Okay. So the only two would be the hydrocodone and the amitriptyline that are actually controlled substances. Correct?
That were the parents that were found, yes.
Okay. And of the actual ones that were in the system that were active, I guess is what I would say. Were any of them illegal substances?
In the state of Mississippi, the hydrocodone and amitriptyline are all prescription drugs, so they require a doctor's prescription. As far as the marijuana metabolite, as you stated before, there are certain circumstances where medicinal marijuana has come into play as of 2021 when this occurred.
And I guess what I'm asking you is what was actually found in the blood, which was the metabolite, is that illegal whatsoever?
I'm not sure.
The metabolite was not the illegal, correct?
I do not believe so.
Okay. The was it Delta 9 THC would be illegal?
Yes.
Or unless you have some sort of prescription.
Yes, it'll be the product of that controlled substance.
No further questions, Tom.
All right. You can read that, Rick?
Approximately 4 hours after the crash, and you cannot who testified, you cannot say what her blood alcohol level would have been at the time of the crash. I'm asking you, in your professional opinion, what could it have been? I know there may be several scenarios.
Yes. So, unless any alcohol is consumed post-crash, there are three scenarios for blood alcohol analysis. The blood could have been either the same as it was, the 0.273, at the time of the crash. It could have been higher or lower. There are scenarios if it was the same. It could have been a 0.273 at the time of the crash. She could have said there still could be residual alcohol in the stomach to be absorbed. The blood alcohol level could rise and then fall back down to that 0.273. It could have been higher at the time, meaning that all the alcohol that was consumed was absorbed into her system, which means it would have been higher at the crash, and then it would have eliminated over the 4 hours to the 0.273. And it could have been lower than the 0.273 at the time of the crash, meaning there was a large bolus dosage of alcohol still to be absorbed. It could have been risen. Alcohol takes about 30 minutes to an hour to absorb, fully absorb into your system. And it could have risen and then come back down to that 0.273.
So in your opinion, prior to the drawing of the blood, we've heard testimony that she was driving erratically all over the road, running off the side of the road, speeding, almost going into the other lane of traffic, the oncoming traffic. Would that be clear indications that she was under the influence at the time she was driving?
Those are indications that a person could be under the influence of alcohol at the time.
And then we had testimony that she was seen vomiting after the accident. Would that also be an indication?
It could be an indication, yes.
I mean, I believe you testified a little earlier that vomiting would be a sign of someone that had really had a great deal of alcohol.
In general, yes.
And you testified about the other, the hydrocodone, antitriptyline, and nortriptyline, am I saying that?
Amitriptyline, yes.
With those in her system drinking alcohol, would that have had an effect?
Yes, they would have had an effect with the ethanol that would be on board.
No more questions, thank you.